afternoon, everyone, and welcome. My name is Rhonda Livingstone, and I'm a civil celebrant. I have been given the honour of leading this farewell service today, and on behalf of the family of Peter Allen Magill, I thank you for coming to his ceremony, and especially those of you who have travelled some distance to be here. Today is an event to honour and to remember Peter's life, and a way for all of you to connect with each other, share all of your memories and pay tribute to him. I would now like to welcome and acknowledge those who are watching our service online, as your presence is also deeply appreciated. And before we begin, and just to ensure we don't have interruptions today throughout our service, if I could kindly remind everyone, just to ensure mobile phones are now switched to silent. Thank you. As you are all aware, a fine, caring, good-hearted man has been lost to us. And although Peter is now at rest, we gather today to perform a very difficult task, both to mourn, but also to celebrate his life. All of us are now reminded that the slender thread that joins life with death can so quickly be broken, and that the grieving process which follows is like a roller coaster, full of ups and downs and highs and lows. Like many roller coasters, the ride will be rougher in the beginning. The lows will be deeper and longer. And our hearts reach out today to those who were closest to Peter. And our thoughts are especially with his loving wife, Barbara, together for nearly 53 years. And his children, Rodney, Tracy, and Belinda, deceased. Peter was also the much-loved father-in-law to Peter and fond brother of Raymond, Kevin, Ronald, Doreen, deceased, and Kathleen, as well as the affectionate uncle to his many nieces and nephews. It's also very important to remember the close relationship that Peter shared as the adored pop to Ian, Julianne, Nicole, deceased, Charlotte, Christine, and Emily. And of course, we think also of all of you, everyone that's here today, and Peter's caring ways will certainly be remembered by you all. So throughout our service, we're going to fashion a painting of Peter's life and his character with poems, his life story, family memories, and a slideshow. There'll be many happy thoughts, but also many sad thoughts and many, many recollections. And hopefully when you leave our service, you will take with you deeper understanding and a much more personal picture of him today. And of course, Peter will be forever tied together within his family circle. The younger generation will no doubt carry on with some of his talents, his skills and traditions that have been passed down to them. Peter loved his family, and no doubt his heritage will continue. So to commence our service, I would like to present our first reading, titled Legacy of Love, listed in your order of service. A husband, a father, our pop too. This is the legacy we have from you. You taught us love and how to fight. You gave us strength, you gave us might. A stronger person would be hard to find. And in your heart, you were always kind. You fought for us all in one way or another, not just as a husband and not just as a father. For all of us, you gave your best. Now the time has come for you to rest. So go in peace. You've earned your sleep. Your love in our hearts we'll eternally keep. And of course, for some moments in life, there's no words. When we lose a loved one, death and grief make us all feel very uncomfortable. And although, in a practical sense, Peter's no longer part of your lives, death can also be regarded as simply a shedding of the physical body, like the butterfly that sheds its cocoon, then transitioning to a much higher state of consciousness. Some people believe in afterlife, but none of us really know. Perhaps we can all hope that there is another dimension or place where we will all live on. We know that when plants and flowers shed their seeds and the wind and the rain carry them to another place, it is the beginning of new life. And as we all know, death can occur in many ways. It can be sudden, expected, prolonged, or accidental. And part of that experience is finding ways to express what has happened, to make sense of what has happened, finally to accept what has happened, and then try and learn to let go. Know that tears are not a sign of weakness. Falling apart is part of the normal grieving and healing process. And immediately now, all of your thoughts will be turning to Peter's personality and his character. Cheeky man, good sense of humour. The word stubborn, I'm told, also springs to mind. He had firm ideas on most things. You always knew where you stood. He loved his family and he was a patient, kind-hearted, proud dad, proud granddad. He never missed an opportunity to spend time with his grandchildren. And he was inspirational in their devotion and care. He loved to tickle them, loved to have fun, but also, I'm told, he enjoyed his peace when they did go home. When they're all together and the noise increased, he often referred to his grandchildren as a herd of cattle. Throughout his life, Peter was a hard worker, never afraid to get his hands dirty, undertaking both farming as well as process work, and more of which will be discussed by his daughter Tracy in his eulogy. There's no doubt Peter was dedicated to Barbara. They shared a wonderful marriage, wonderful togetherness, and they enjoyed socialising with friends, both domestic and overseas travel together. And on a personal level, Peter enjoyed listening to music on the radio, loved to follow and watch the cricket, and was a passionate gardener. It was important for him to relax and spend time in his garden each day. And of course, no one will fit into Peter's shoes, but the influence of his personality and his character will always live on in the thoughts of you all. When we continue to think about his life, there is a lot more to reflect upon. So it is my privilege to now ask his daughter Tracy to please come forward and share with you her dad's life story. Thanks, Tracy.
Dad was born in Blighttown to John and Dora Magill, also known as Jack. He was the fourth son, and with two daughters that followed years later. They lived at Plumpton on a family farm. They moved to Austral when Dad was about 11 years old, when they had another poultry farm. Dad went to an all-boys high school in Liverpool, although he left in Form 9 at the age of 14 to work on the family farm. At 17, Dad met Mum at a youth dance after his cousins took Mum to the dance. Dad married Mum at the age of 18 on the 11th of October. They moved to Marylands after their marriage. This was where they brought their first dog, Scamp. They moved to Maitland, where Dad worked as a truck driver, delivering drinks. This is where Rodney was born. Mum and Dad came back to Campbelltown, Liverpool area after his father had a massive heart attack. They started to build in Narellan not long after this. This is where we settled, having myself and Belinda. Dad started on the coal trucks just prior to my birth. Some of you may remember him being called Beetroot. Mum was explaining to the grandkids the other day that Dad had picked, someone had lost a load of beetroot on the new bridge that had been built. Dad stopped and picked them up and brought them home. So that's how he got his name. Mum remembers when Dad took her down the big hill in the valley to see if he could induce labour with myself. It did not work. Dad was the last one that had a Mercedes-Benz truck, as he was a very cautious driver. This is something that has passed on to all of us. I can remember Dad making sure that he taught each of us how to drive, but he also made us change the tyre, the water and the oil before we could even get in the car. During this time, Dad met his two friends, Colin Jensen and Rodney McAway. They lived three houses from our family. Every Christmas, they would get together, going to each other's house, putting the Christmas presents together. One year, they built a swing set, bikes, and the last was a trampoline, which by the time they were there, they were very drunk as skunks by midnight, leaving a note from Santa explaining why only half of it got put together and missing the springs. After 15 years of driving coal trucks, Dad took a redundancy. Although he continued to drive trucks for a nursery business delivering plants, this is when he started working weekends for his brother Kevin and Rodney Watson. As kids, Dad took us on road trips and holidays. We travelled, visiting places like Kiama, Lakes Entrance, but most of all, we would come down to Findlay to visit his cousin, Eric, at Easter. Sometimes we stayed in the tram. Dad did renovations on our house. When Rodney and Mum can both remember, Dad carrying installation across the roof and him dropping it through the bathroom. Mum wanted a skylight to go over the bath, but it ended up over the shower. Prior to moving into the area, Dad applied for GV Water Commission, although he had to learn to swim. I remember Dad taking us over to swimming lessons. Then we'd have to wait around for him to have his lessons. Dad absolutely hated water. In 1989, we left Narellan, moving to Sandmount Road after Dad and Mum bought the property. Dad came to grow kangaroo paw and proteas. In the move, Mum remembers our dog Penny having to go back on the back of the moving truck in a trailer. When Penny would become one of Dad's best friends, following him everywhere over the farm. He taught her and her daughter, Tash, how to round up the cows. And when he needed them to do some work, Dad would get cranky at times because Penny, her best friend Misty, the cat, would go through the cattle as she thought she was a dog and spreading them everywhere. The cat followed him through the paddocks even when he was watering them. Dad started working at the Scots Rotary after we arrived. He started Murray Goulburn 12 months later until he retired. Dad got venturous when he built our house, knocking down a 100-year-old house for the wood, which is where McDonald's stands today. He used the wood to build the house, and the flooring in that house became our lounge room roof and kitchen roof. Dad was always knocking things down and building, fixing and starting with the arches at the house in Narellan. Then he turned that house into a two-storey house. This rubbed off to both Rodney and I. Dad taught us also how to milk a cow by hand, swing a hammer, and his passion for gardening, and how not to renovate our houses, although he always was making sure we did everything right. Dad adored his grandchildren. He taught them how to drive on his knee, most of them before they could walk. He planted Tom Thumb tomatoes, especially for Emily, as the big ones were too big for her. Although they used to wear the tomato seeds, eating them and running around the tomato shed. They were taught to feed the calves and look after all the animals. Dad had them all following him around the farm everywhere he went when they visited. Every grandchild had time on his knee asleep after he gave them cuddles. It was a fight between him and Mum to who had them for their naps. Dad made us who we are today with his strength, resilience and worth ethics.
Thank you so much, Tracy, for sharing those wonderful memories of Dad. And it's not easy to stand up here in front of you all at such an emotional time. I know everyone appreciated it. And to continue to paint our picture of Peter, I would now like to ask his grandchildren, Christine, Charlotte and Ian, to please come forward and say a few words about their pop. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Charlotte, for all those who aren't familiar. I am one of Peter's granddaughters, and today, alongside me and my two cousins, Christine and Ian, we would like to reintroduce you to the man we knew as Pop or Poppy. We are here today to remember the life and legacy that he leaves on this earth. For all of us, he was a big part of who we are and who we are yet to become. We could all stand here for the better half of the day and reminisce about all the stories Pop was either a part of or that he told. And for those that knew Pop, you would understand how long those stories could be. We will cover some of those, but overall, we'd like to remember the person Pop was and how he impacted our lives and many others. To the grandchildren, Pop was in many ways a father figure, a role model of sorts. Pop admired us all in different ways and cherished every moment he spent watching us grow, laugh and play. Our childhoods consisted of being very close to our grandparents. They taught us the family values which we all always take with us. In the earliest of days, he taught us many things, but most of all, he taught us how to laugh with his sense of humour. From tickling us until our ribs hurt to creating fear in the eyes when it came to a simple dam on their farm, which he'd tell us contained crocodiles, so we would stay away. For safety, of course, but clearly, now we look back at all the small quirks he had and laugh. I remember once when the youngest of us grandchildren realised there were tadpoles in that very same dam. He grabbed a bucket and fetched them for us. For days, we watched them grow and we were fascinated. In the end, she took them to kindergarten for show and tell, to tell all the kids and watch them. But in all the efforts, he went for us to show what kind of grandfather he was, going out of his way to share the small things that make everything worthwhile. To this day, the biggest memories all of us grandchildren share are the holidays we got to spend together on the farm. Here, Pop taught us many life skills we'd never forget, from learning how to milk cattle to feeding potty calves, who we always get way too attached to, of course. Most of all, Pop taught us what hard work looks like, especially from a young age. As Nan would put it, he knew how to get free labour, as we used to pick all the tomatoes in the shed.
In all honesty, I don't think we have such a strong bond with animals if it wasn't for Pop. He taught us how to raise them from babies and showed us that all animals were a part of the family, from Spot the cow who we raised, as well as the dog that we'd never forget, like Tash. And in all honesty, our grandparents were very open about the circle of life, like watching Pop kill chickens from when the time came is something we'll never forget, especially with them running around without heads. Most of all, Pop taught us how to be ourselves, how to be family, and for him, we are grateful at how close we all become. Maybe there are some downfalls when we're all together, because he often compares us to a herd of cattle when we're all together, and often Nan would say that we're just too loud. While staying with Nan and Pop, we were all compared to cows in regards to the amount of food that we were having, and then always having room for dessert. We always say that we're full until somehow we have that second stomach when it came to that dessert. Most mornings, while spending holidays at our grandparents, Pop would prove how much of a morning person that he was. He was always up at the crack of dawn, even after they moved into town. This, for us grandchildren, was great because we would always wake up to the smell of breakfast. There's a small debate on which breakfast was the most iconic that he made for us. Each kid had their own specific one from what he was making, from bacon and eggs to spaghetti on toast, or the soldiers and the gooey eggs, but we can all agree that his favourite was Weet-Bix. We all know Pop would have done anything for us grandchildren, as he adored and loved every moment that he spent with us. This includes swapping Pop's black socks that he was already wearing with his grandson's white socks so he didn't stand out and look too crazy at his own deb. Pop certainly had a huge love for cricket. Most of us had no clue what was going on during a cricket game, but he always played it every year in the background to fill in the noise at family gatherings. With new additions of partners joining our family over the years, Pop finally had someone he could sit down with, talk to, and enjoy that love for cricket with. Our entire family would like to thank you all for joining us in reminiscing on the life that we shared with Pop. As you all know, he was a very kind, considerate, and a cheeky little man. We are all grateful for the time that we got with Pop, the life that he lived, and the memories that we have to share with you. Pop will always be a part of our lives and a part of our hearts. Thank you.
Thank you so much for speaking bravely, openly about your granddad, and your Pop would be very proud of you today. Everyone that's here has left an imprint on the fabric of Peter's life, and as life events unfold, they become rich with colour and with pattern. Peter's life has been full. He enjoyed his life, shared his wisdom, passed the goodness on, used his love of life to guide him until it was his time to go. Many people will walk in and out of your life, but only true friends leave footprints in your hearts. And Peter was a good friend to you all. And when we listen to the fun stories from Tracy and from the grandchildren, it reminds us that memories are now the greatest possession that we have. And the wealth of those memories has been captured by the family today in visual images as part of our service. With the passing of Peter Magill, a page of history has now closed. So I will ask everyone to observe a few moments' silence. Time for quiet thought. Perhaps turn back some of the pages of Peter's book. And whilst viewing the slideshow, please now recall the happy times that all of you have spent with him. Remember your own personal relationship that each of you shared with Peter.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear. Hour I first believed, when we've been there, sound that saved a wretch like me.
Some wonderful images and memories there of Peter that will remain with you all. And he has left kindness and involvement in everyone's hearts. And for all of us now, yesterday becomes history. Tomorrow is still a mystery and today a gift, and why it is called the present. As we know, Peter was in love with gardening and it was his favourite pastime. He spent many hours taking care of plants and experiencing their beauty and their rewards. So please now take a moment to remember Peter the next time you find yourself in a lovely garden, whilst I ask his cousin Eric to please come forward and present our second reading, titled A Garden's Magic, also listed in your order of service. Thanks, Eric.
As you see, the heading is A Garden's Magic. Well, isn't that a wonderful thing to have as a heading? Because Peter wasn't happy unless he had dirt under his fingernails. He just loved his garden. This is the garden's magic, that through the sunny hours, the gardener who tends it himself outgrows his flowers. He grows by gift of patience, since he who sows must know that only in the Lord's good time does any flower grow. He learns from bud unfolding, from each tight leaf unfurled, that his own heart expanding is one with all the world. He bears his head to sunshine, his bending back a sign of grace, and every shower becomes his sacramental wine. And when at last his labours bring forth the very stuff and substance of all beauty, this is reward enough. Now let us all believe that Peter is in this lovely garden that he's dreamt of all his life, and he's there celebrating with his daughter Belinda, his sister Doreen, and his mother and father Jack and Doreen Magill. And I'm sure they're all having a lovely time together while we are losing tears over the loss of him with us.
Thank you so much, Eric, for sharing that poem. It was a beautiful choice. Today, we have all acknowledged our appreciation for the privilege of sharing a part of Peter's life. He maintained good health throughout most of his life until first diagnosed with cancer in 2018. After undergoing treatment, Peter went into remission until the cancer returned in December of last year. And recently his health further declined and he spent 2 weeks in Cobram Hospital, where he sadly passed away on the 21st of September, aged 72 years. On behalf of the family, I would like to offer thanks to the hospital staff for their help and support, as well as thanks to Shepparton Oncology and to Peter Mack. Special thanks are also extended to Barbara, who showed the true meaning of love and helped and gave Peter strength in dealing with his day-to-day life. Peter's courage shone through to the end. He set a wonderful example to all those who loved him. And to conclude our service today, I ask you to now become as one with Peter whilst I present our closing words. Think of me now as one at rest. For me, you should not weep. I have no pain, no troubled thoughts, for I am just asleep. The living, thinking me that was is now forever still, and life goes on without me, as time forever will. Those of you who liked me, I sincerely thank you all. And those of you who loved me, I thank you most of all. Here now in this final act, we tenderly and reverently commit the body of our dear friend Peter to the elements of cremation from which all life comes and in the end all life returns. Earth to earth, dust to dust, and ashes to ashes. We leave him in peace and with respect, all bid him farewell. At the conclusion of our service, the family invite you to share refreshments at the adjoining hall next door, where you can continue to recall the happy times that each of you have shared with Peter. So let us all now go in peace, supporting each other. And our final music tribute is the song How's That? And a tribute to Peter's love of the game of cricket. Hopefully when you hear this song in the future, you'll think about Peter and be able to smile. Thank you all once again for your attendance, your love and support here today.